thanks again for being here.
My pleasure.
And if we could just start off with you stating your name.
Mm-hmm. I'm Valora Washington.
Okay, and can you tell us what years did you attend Lyndon McKinley High School, and how old were you in 71, and what grade were you in?
So I attended Lyndon McKinley High School for all four of my high school years. I was 17 years old in 1971 and a senior at Lyndon McKinley High School.
Okay, thank you. So were you and your peers, when I say peers, I mean your age group peers, were you, I guess maybe generation is a better term, were you exposed to Black culture in grade school or high school, junior high school? Did you find that your curriculum at any point reflected the presence of Black people? Mm-hmm.
Well, most certainly I was exposed to Black culture. I grew up in a Black family, in a Black neighborhood, and for the most part, I went to all Black schools until high school, and was a very active member of our local Baptist church. And in the church, we had a lot of opportunity to learn about Black poets, Black artists, and so forth within the church setting. But in school, it was a very different story. So for example, in elementary school, I remember very clearly, as a very early reader myself, that we were using in school a basal reading series called Alice, Jerry, and Jip. Alice and Jerry being a brother and sister, and Jip being their little dog. And they were supposed to represent a typical American family. It was a very white family, very white environment that they were in. The stories that we were learning to read from revolved around their experiences in their kinds of neighborhoods and their kinds of families. And I remember thinking that it was just very different from what we were experiencing. But that's how we learned to read.
I see. So then at some point, did you want to learn Black history? I understand that you had exposure outside of school, so you were aware that you had Black history. But did you want to learn more, and why?
Mm-hmm. I really, from a very young age, was very curious about Black history. My family had immigrated from the South, from Georgia. I was very curious about why so many of my family members had left Georgia and moved to Ohio, Philadelphia, Detroit, and Chicago. I was very curious about that. And of course, it was fun to learn these things, but I also wanted to learn because there was so much emphasis in school when they talked about Black people at all. It was all about the Civil War and the slavery experience. It was not about the experience of being enslaved. It was the experience of being a slave. So that was always a little off-putting for me. And a lot of American history just didn't make sense because it didn't include a lot of the Black experience, which is so central to American experience. And a lot of the discrimination and the racism that I saw in the world cannot be understood if you didn't have some understanding of that history. So this was always a strong desire for me to know more.
I see. So as a young person, then were you aware of, say from your during your high school years, were you aware of the political and social turmoil that was happening in the country at large? And what were your feelings or thoughts, if you had any?
Well, without question. I mean, I started high school about 1968, and everybody knows what a pivotal year that was in our nation. So there's no way that I or anybody else could have been not exposed to the kinds of tensions and opportunities and disagreements and challenges that were happening at our nation in that time, largely revolving around racial issues, though not exclusively. So we were just coming of age in high school in this dynamic environment of 1968, and also Lyndon McKinley High School at that time, I believe, was a very mixed race environment. About half the students were Black and about half the students were white. We were coming together in a very volatile era in our nation. So, of course, quite naturally, these issues began to come to the fore. Lyndon McKinley High School at that time didn't really have much in the way of Black history or Black curriculum or teachers. So a lot of these questions began to come up. We were obviously, as young people, impacted by what was going on in the world around us and asking questions about which we were not receiving answers.
And how did that dissonance make you feel? I mean, you see all these things happening around you, yet in your immediate environment, the learning environment that you were in, it was not being addressed. How did you process that?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I think it's very eye-opening experience, particularly coming to Lyndon, when many of the children in my classes, I was in all of the what you might today call gifted classes. At that particular time in history, many classes were ranked according to what people thought your ability was. And so being in a certain type of classes, of course, many of my classes were majority, if not all white, except for me, in a school that was pretty much 50-50. And also at Lyndon McKinley High School, there were barriers. Basically, the Black children were coming from one set of neighborhoods and the white children were coming from another set of neighborhoods, developing friendships and acquaintanceships with many of the other children from other cultures. You begin to see very many differences in neighborhoods up front and personal in a way that, coming from segregated neighborhoods, I really hadn't seen before. And also in high school, particularly in 1971 when I was a senior, we're all beginning to think about, what is our future going to be? What is our next steps going to be? And it became very clear to me about the educational inequities, that many of my peers were not going to have opportunities to perhaps go to college or do the kinds of things that they wanted to do, that they were capable of doing. So all of these questions were emerging upon us as we were just about to set sail into the world.
Wow. And so just to backtrack a little bit to the school itself, was there racial tension in the school and or in the community? And can you speak to that a little bit? Was it something you picked up on, given the fact that you obviously were very aware of a lot of nuances, and I guess more direct things as well? But can you speak to that racial tension?
Well, the racial tensions, I think, evolved. You know, a lot of what could be thought of as racial tension maybe seemed natural to some people. Maybe it just seemed natural to people that, you know, Black students were in certain sorts of classes and white students were in other kinds of classes. And it seemed natural to people that certain children were going to have certain opportunities and other people weren't. So, you know, a lot of times until we call attention to these kinds of inequities, many people think it's normal. It's just like that frog in a pot of boiling water. It just feels natural. It's like a fish in the river. It feels natural. And so it's by asking the questions that discomfort arises. If you start to make inquiries and start to wonder why and start to wonder how, and that becomes uncomfortable. And particularly in an environment where the faculty and administration themselves didn't share many of the experiences that the children had, it was uncomfortable for them as well.
Gotcha. So you were a part of a group of Black students who met outside of school. And can you talk a little bit about why you all were meeting and what you talked about and maybe some of your peers who were in that group?
So remember this era in the 60s and 70s where people were having a lot of rap groups and discussions. Also in the city of Columbus, there's a huge park here called Franklin Park, which at that particular era On Sundays at Franklin Park, lots of black people from all over the city would gather, and there would be poetry readings and people rapping and people hanging out and talking. So there was a lot of these rap sessions and educational sessions and things like that going on. People having a lot of conversations about what was going on in the world. And so I think when we first started to talk as peers at Lynn McKinley High School, it was really in that context, in the context of this is what was happening in the world. We were aware that on college campuses, people were having education sit-ins and talking, and we were just continuing those kind of conversations among ourselves. So I think it started off just with us wanting to learn and to hear. What are you thinking? What are you experiencing? What are your plans after this senior year? I think it started there. And I think it then evolved to, well, we'd like to participate in making things better. We're about to graduate, but wouldn't it be great if Linden had a Black History course or more Black teachers or more opportunities for us to be counseled and supported as we go off into our futures? And so the conversations just begin to evolve.
And as you all were meeting on a regular basis and you were having these conversations, what were the things that you wanted? I mean, were there things, what were the things that you wanted from your school? What were the things that you wanted at large?
Well, some of the things that we wanted were just things that were unique to that era. For example, during all of my years at Linden, I was very active on the newspaper staff and on the yearbook staff. So, as an active member of the newspaper and yearbook, I can remember writing stories on questions like, what do you think about girls wearing pants to school? And I remember I did a big article on that. I went around and interviewed a lot of the teachers, a lot of the students, male and female, around this really important question about girls wearing pants to school. Okay. So many of the questions were things that were just a part of that era. And what we wanted were a more relaxation of a lot of things that we considered to be rigid at that time, like dress codes, school lunches, things that are perennial issues that teenagers talk about. But then there were deeper issues and serious issues around, what today I think people understand to be very clear racial inequities, very clear educational inequities, lack of opportunity, things that today nobody would question that that was the situation in the 70s. But at that time, when you're talking about it seems shocking to people. Well, what do you mean there's an educational inequity? So things that today we see more clearly were felt a little more obscure to people at that time.
Okay, wow. So within this environment, and particularly given your experiences with the yearbook and with being on the newspaper staff, did you have white friends?
Oh,
And if you
absolutely.
did, were those friendships affected by racial tension? And if so, how?
So in my classes, because of the nature of the types of classes I was taking, being active on the newspaper and so forth, of course, I had a lot of white friends and acquaintances. But I think those tensions, but also the opportunities and the outreach began to really formulate. For example, white friends would invite me over to their homes for dinner, which would require going to the other part of town where they lived and, sitting with their families and, their families at the dinner table feeling a little bit awkward and so forth. So there were a lot of those kinds of learning and growing experiences that we were having, not just as teenagers, but within our families and communities as well.
Okay. So I'm gonna move a little bit forward in the school year. But first of all, let's start with February. Were you at the Black History Week performance?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Can you describe for us what your experience was there, what you saw and what happened at the play?
Well, I think it just became a very chaotic situation in the auditorium. I mean, again, many of the students were exploring these issues of identity for the first time. People were asking a lot of questions. There was a lot of lack of clarity. You know, I can remember as part of the program, one of the things that happened is that people were singing the Black National Anthem. And I remember many students, Black and white, not being familiar with that song. And of course, I was quite familiar with it because it was something that we would have in a church experience or a church environment. And I think there was questions that people had. And again, without adults there who could really mediate and facilitate dialogue, because of the lack of diversity among the staff and the limited experiences of the staff, things just became chaotic among the students themselves. Obviously, this kind of thing leads to people having anger and bitterness, not knowing what to do with the questions and the emotions that they're feeling. I think that there were some white students who were beginning to feel very alienated and upset, and there were some white male students who at that time threw posters overboard or flyers over the balcony, really in a protest against what they were seeing as a real encroachment of these questions in the environment in a way they were never expecting to experience in their lives.
Did you happen to see one of the flyers?
Oh, yes.
And do you remember, if you don't remember verbatim, you know, it was a while ago, but can you just sort of speak to what the content of the flyers was?
Now, I actually don't remember the content of the flyers, but what I remember the sentiment of the flyers being something like, you know, white students should unite and not tolerate this kind of questioning.
Oh, wow. Okay. Okay. Interesting. So then let's move a little further into the year, into May. And I wonder if you could describe the meeting that you attended at Bethel AME Church on the evening of May 24th, 1971.
Well, I think within the city, within the school, within the communities, tensions were building. Again, this was not unique to Linda McKinley High School. It was not unique to Columbus, Ohio. This is the United States of America that we were living in that era. And tensions were mounting. Particularly around school issues and so forth. And so there was a meeting called that was held at the church. I remember very clearly it was standing room only. A lot of adults were there, a lot of parents were there, and authority figures wanting to explain or talk about some of the tensions that were building. I left the meeting with a clear sense that it had not been helpful in alleviating those tensions at all. In fact, it raised more questions and more concerns. And so I did not find that meeting to be a place where there was any closure or any sense of what the next steps might be. The adults did most of the talking. And I think at that point, a lot of the parents were very concerned.
And why is that? Why did you feel that it wasn't, that there was no closure? What did happen? What did come out of it?
I won't be able to say what came out of it because, of course, being a teenager, perhaps there's things that came out of it that about which I was not aware. However, I can say that following the meeting and the kind of lingering that people have after a meeting, there were still angry talk. There was still upsetness. There was not a sense of clarity. There was not an aha moment, you know. So, you know, the tensions were not reduced as a result of the meeting.
Okay, and so then what happened after the meeting? Can you describe what happened and what happened at the school?
So just as I was in conversations with my peers, there were obviously lots of conversations going on about which I did not participate or I wasn't aware. So what I know is that when I arrived at school the next day, the Black Nationalist flag or the African American flag was on the school building instead of the United States flag. So someone had removed the United States flag and replaced it with the red, black, and green. And so that became immediately obvious as something that was plain to see as we all were coming to school the next day. Who put it there? What happened as a result to have it put there? I don't know. I know that it was there and it was causing a lot of conversation.
And so how did you feel when you saw that flag when you got to school?
You know, I said, somebody's been busy overnight. So, you know, it was not disturbing to me. I understand it was disturbing to a number of people. I know that other people were celebrating that it happened. Some people were disturbed. Some people were celebrating. I was observing that it had happened. I was not aware that it had been planned, but it had clearly happened.
Okay. And so then later in that same day, there was an assembly that happened, an unauthorized assembly that happened. Were you at that gathering?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So can you describe what happened there and what happened afterward?
I don't know what happened there. Again, I think that continuing from what had been happening in the previous days, there was a lot of conversation. There was a lot of questions. What I really want to point out now, since this was many decades ago, and what we know now, is when you are lacking adult leadership and lacking adults who can have dialogue with children, who are open to listening to the questions that teenagers are raising, who have answers or at least who can explore issues with teens in some kind of open way, who are skilled in facilitating dialogue and bringing people together and fostering unity, who can be honest and authentic in their responses, you're going to have troubles. So I think that many people think on this incident as the teenagers took over. And I think another additional way of thinking about it is, where were the adults and where was the adult leadership? And when you have an adult leadership that is of a different race and a different generation and not relating to students, and who feel that the appropriate response is punitive, or who feel that the appropriate response is anger, and who are upset that a question is asked rather than open to dialogue, that is going to become a volatile situation. Where are the adults? Where is the adult leadership?
I see. That's a very good question, and thank you for pointing out that context, because I think that is important for sure. Because after all, you were in a place of learning, so you're thinking, and you're coming up with ideas, and you're processing the world. So, with that said, can you speak to what happened following that assembly, and with the arrival of the cops, of the police, and so what you saw and what you experienced and how you felt?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think one of the most horrific things that can ever happen in a public education setting happened, which is a massive show of force by fully armed police officers at a public school. And this is what happened. So you had students, we were all asked to sit in the hallways. So you had students sitting in the hallways. I think that many of the students, as well as faculty, were completely shocked at what was going on. It was unanticipated. And when you're having a militaristic, dominating show of force of a kind that you would hope would never, ever happen in the United States of America anywhere. It was a stunning experience. I can remember very recently speaking to a student who was in this situation with us at that time, who said to me, even quite recently, not understanding what was going on, that it was a chilling moment and a life-changing moment for him. So all of these decades later, he's still very shaken up by having experienced something of that nature. So this was unbelievable that something like that would happen in a public school in the United States of America, then or now.
Can you tell us what you saw, like just what your visual memories of the events were?
So from my position of sitting on the floor in the hallway, I could see very large men fully dressed in what seemed to be military type guard, armed, marching up and down the hallways. That's what I saw. And none of us knew why. We didn't know what they were gonna do. We didn't know how long we would be sitting there. We didn't know what the potential outcomes of that experience would be. So it was a fear-inducing, very aggressive act that none of us had anticipated or could have known what was going on. I don't think that was just true of students. I think it was also true of many of the teachers who were there, who also didn't know why, when, or what was going on.
Did you see the police hit children or use force against any of the students?
I did not see that, but I did, but their very presence was quite intimidating. But I did not see them actually assault anyone physically. The whole experience was assaulting. It was an assaulting experience, but I did not see a physical violence myself. I did not see that.
And if you could say, you know, as best you can, how did you feel in those moments when you were sitting on the floor and you were seeing what you described, these large men coming and they were armed and you're a teenager who's at school? How did you feel?
Well, I think I, like everybody else, I felt afraid. There were children crying. I felt afraid, very fearful, not knowing what was going to happen. So it was fear. It was just raw fear. These are things you saw on TV. So on television, we would see in some of the marches, and I'm going to say this, in the South, we would see police beating people, dogs attacking people. These were things that were happening in the South. Okay. So to see this kind of fear-inducing experience in a high school in the North where we were was something that was shocking. And witnessing something like that on TV is a horrifying experience. Personally experiencing it and witnessing it is far worse.
So you would say that it was traumatic?
It was a traumatic experience. Absolutely. I think for everyone.
And to your knowledge, were any support services offered to the students after this event, after this incident?
So what we know today as adults, that if there is a traumatic experience of any kind in a school setting, that support personnel would be immediately called in. Medical personnel, counselors, all kinds of people to offer support in a traumatic experience. And there would be some type of trauma-informed care. There was nothing. There was not a word from a teacher, from an administrator, from any kind of other support services. Nothing was offered. So each of us was left to process this on our own, with our friends, with our families. But there was no support whatsoever. And the intention was school would just go on as usual after we all had experienced this horrible event. And that was it. There was no conversation, no processing of what had happened, no explanation. And for many students, even to this day, they don't know what happened. They don't know what caused it. They don't know what the results were. It was something that happened one day that was horrible, and we were all just left alone to deal with it in our own way. And it reminds me of other kinds of traumas that people experience, where they may experience shame, let's say in a sexual assault or something like that, and they're left alone to process it and deal with it on their own and to pretend that nothing happened. And we were all assaulted in that way as a community, and nothing was ever said about it. Nothing was ever done about it.
And so that day, after the at the point at which the police, do you remember how long they were there?
No, because it just felt like forever at the time. So I have no idea about actually how much time passed. I remember feeling that I didn't know how long this would last or what would happen as a result of it.
And did you, when you left school that day, when you finally did leave and go home, did you come back to school after that? And
oh,
can you
absolutely.
Talk about what the end of this school year was like?
Yeah, as I said, there was no discussion of this traumatic experience. There was no support of this experience. Teachers didn't bring it up. Administrators didn't bring it up. We were all just expected to come back to school and have school as usual. So, and of course, there was the graduation and so forth that just went on. By that time, I graduated from high school, went to college, and that was the end of it. And until very recently, when I've been receiving phone calls to talk about this experience, nobody has even asked us about what happened.
Wow. And did the school close down? Was the school shut down early in the academic year? Was it shut down before it was originally planned to?
I don't recall. Somehow it does feel that there were some days off or some days when it was closed, but I don't really remember specifically about it.
Okay.
You know, when a traumatic experience occurs, a lot of the details of that nature become a blur. And I know that a lot of people were staying away from school because of fear, and school attendance slacked off, that kind of thing. Because it was a very upsetting experience that was associated with that environment.
Okay, thank you. So I want to ask you a bit about Dr. Charles Ross, and if you knew him or were aware of him, and if so, how?
Yeah, absolutely. I knew Dr. Charles Ross because he was a professor at the university, which to us was such an amazing thing. And he was one of the few people who made himself available to answer questions and to explain to us something about the history of African people in the diaspora, to explain to us about various inequities, to give us some connection to the events that were happening in the world around us. So he was very much, as I perceived him to be, a teacher, really teaching, listening, answering questions, asking questions of us.
Okay. I'm sorry, I just got a note here. I do want to ask you also about, you had two Black studies teachers at Linda McKinley, is that correct?
In the later years, yes.
And so did you have the opportunity to take classes with them, or did you associate with them at all? That was Gary Davis and Bruce Bunch?
Of course. Now, of course I knew who they were and so forth, but I was so far along in my curriculum, and I was in a kind of curriculum that by the time they came, I really didn't have a space to take actual work with them. But of course, I was very aware of their coming, and their coming was so celebrated. People were very happy when they came, and you know, and I think students really admired them and looked up to them a great deal.
I see. So they were advisors as well as, I guess, sort of those listening ears that you referred mm-hmm. to before. Okay. So I also wanted to ask you about in your group, in the group that you were in, the sort of core group that you were in, were you the only girl? Were there other girls that you knew who were equally concerned about politics and social change?
You know, so that's a challenging question. So what I would say is, again, let's look at the era in which we were in. I already told you that as a student journalist, I was doing stories on, you know, girls' dress code and these kinds of questions that were coming in. And not only was this an era where people were thinking about their racial identity, it was also an era where people were thinking a lot about their gender identity as well. And so clearly there were a lot of girls and young women who were asking questions and thinking about these issues. I think many people would say to you that I was the most consistent person in the group having the conversation, but there were always other young women in and out of the circle. And again, it's a large school, so there are lots of circles going on and lots of conversations going on, but questions of gender and were big in that era, and a lot of girls and young women were trying to figure it out as well. We looked out in the world and we saw women in movements who were being strong and courageous and using their voice. And I think many young women at that time were wanting to know what would be an appropriate voice for me.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Can you share with us then, during that time, what were the events that sort of things happening in the country at large, or even in the region, or even in the city, politically or socially, in terms of these movements, what affected you the most? What resonated for you the most? What really, I guess, sort of struck you the hardest or had the most impact?
You know, growing up, I grew up in an era where I didn't watch TV a lot. I don't think most people watch TV a lot, you know. As a child, we played outside and we did a lot of sports activities or other kinds of outdoor activities. Being in the house watching TV was not something that people did. However, during that era, I think it was a time when many people across the country were mesmerized by the TV images they were having about the civil rights struggle and the civil rights issues. I can remember seeing Martin Luther King on television and I'd be spellbound by something like that. Or seeing other kinds of leaders and protests in cities across the country and wondering, okay, what's going on in those cities and what are people saying? These were not typical images of the time. We were all just beginning to really watch TV and have these shared experiences as a nation of seeing these kind of events. And so it was very impactful at that time to see these images. And as you know, the media environment at that time was very limited to three major television stations. So most of us in the United States of America were watching the same thing. And many of us throughout the nation were just stunned by the kinds of things we were seeing. And in my mind, rightly or not, I considered a lot of these things to be Southern phenomena, which of course we quickly learned that they were not. So I would have told you something like that would never have happened in Columbus, Ohio, but obviously it did.
So So, looking around at present day, obviously we've had a very tumultuous year politically and socially. Outside of the beyond the pandemic itself, there have been a number of demonstrations in response to police brutality and other kinds of racial violence and racial aggression. So, can you tell us sort of your feelings on that, and if you see a reflection between the concerns that you and your peers had in 71 and the concerns of now, and how you feel when you see these widespread demonstrations, whether it's Black Lives Matter or other groups that are demonstrating both in the United States and around the world?
So when I think about the Black Lives Matter movement today and a lot of the expressions of social unrest that are going on today, I think there's good news and there's sad news. And I'll start with the sad news first. The sad news is that many things that people are protesting about are things that were also very prominent in much the same way in the 1970s when I was a teenager. That is very sad. So when people are talking about police brutality, when they're talking about educational opportunity, when they're talking about housing disparities, all of these issues have been perennial now for decades from the time when I was a teenager. That is very sad news that we are still not willing as a nation to give every child an opportunity to reach his or her potential. That is so sad and disappointing and upsetting. At the same time, I think the great news about Black Lives Matter is that I am energized and very proud of the young people and young adults who are so articulately and with courage expressing who they are and what they want. And they are strongly doing that. I'm very proud of them. This is an ongoing struggle for equality, for equity, for justice. And I feel proud that there are so many young people taking up this mantle in this relay race. I'm very proud of that. On the other hand, I'm really disappointed that they have to, that this is so many decades later and they're still talking about police brutality. They're still talking about children being tracked into lower educational expectations. We're still having the same conversation. That is very disappointing. And when I look at some of our political leadership today and some of the things that are being quite ungraciously stated in public by high-level political figures, it is stunning. I don't even know in the 70s if somebody might have put it the way that we hear it so boldly stated on television today or on our social media today. So I'm proud of the people that are standing up. I notice there is such a rainbow of people standing up today. When we were doing this in the 70s, of course, yes, there were white allies. But not like there are today. Today, there are allies who are Asian, Black, white, Latino, every group you can possibly think of, gay, straight, everything. I'm delighted to see that kind of diversity. We didn't have that. So, that is part of the good news.
So, thank you for that. So, since you say that, from your vantage point of someone who experienced this as a teenager and is seeing the same, as you call them, perennial issues present with us today, what do you see as a viable way forward to progress beyond these perennial issues remaining issues in the way that they are?
So, I think we are at a turning point in our nation because we're going to have to make some very basic decisions. Let me tell you what is fundamentally different about today. The United States that I grew up in was 85% white. The United States that children today are growing up in is where the children are majority children of color. That is a major game changer. So, when we were growing up in this world where 85% of the Americans were white, blacks were the largest group, minority group. Today, in this mezcla of people that we have, we see that the Latinx are a larger group. So the context for change is enormously different, and it's a tremendous opportunity. When today's children are in the situation that I'm in, looking back 5 decades later, they're going to know that they have grown up in a nation where the typical person is a person of color. And not just that it's a black person, that it could be a brown person, an Asian person, a Latino person. And so that's a major game changer for us. I think if we are going to thrive as a nation, we are going to have to make a fundamental decision to invest in all children, to invest in all people, to be a society that is more people-centric. It's unbelievable that we are among the only nation of our kind that still has no universal health care, that still has no paid maternity leave. These are the kinds of questions and issues that, as a more people-centric nation, we're going to have to resolve. We're going to have to understand that if we don't invest in every child, our nation will not thrive. So when you had a 15% minority population, so to speak, maybe you thought you could get away with not investing in them. But if you don't invest in our children today, we will not survive. We certainly will not thrive as a nation.
Well said. Yeah, agreed. So at this point, did you have anything that you wanted to add?
I really think it is very appropriate for us in Columbus, Ohio, to take a moment to celebrate people like Charles Ross, who had the kind of courage that he had to stand up strongly for something that many people at the time could not understand. I think I also want to commend all the young people of my generation who did not have access to the kinds of information that's available today, but who dared to ask a question when people were aggressively shooting down the questions. And I celebrate that. I also celebrate it because looking back, I know that there's so many people in my generation who have been denied the opportunities to develop their talents and their gifts. And I mourn that because I saw them. I knew their potential. But for very many reasons, because of the kind of a nation that we were, their talents were shut down, shot down. And so I commend them because they've kept going anyway. And they are the ones who gave birth to this new generation who's saying, guess what? Black lives matter. Get over it. And so I'm very proud of them for that.
And since you say that, and forgive me if I'm being redundant, but it brought something to mind that one of your former classmates said to me, when mentioning you specifically and John Wells and John Whitaker, and John Harrington and some of the others, this person made a comment that you all were extremely intelligent, and he said these kids were They had like 4.0 grade averages. They were highly, highly intelligent. And as a matter of fact, Tom Brown said this, the vice principal said the same thing to me. And so I wondered if you could talk a little bit about your friends, your colleagues, your comrades at the time, and yourself, and this whole idea of this talent and who you were as people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's difficult. And so I do think among our generation, there were many very brilliant minds and very courageous people. And I celebrate that, but it's also challenging because it's also in recognition of how many brilliant minds were left behind and not having that opportunity. And for example, in my own life, I've had so many opportunities because of initiatives that existed for a blink in time. And so in that blink, I was fortunate enough to be able to take advantage of that. Many of those initiatives, sorely needed today, no longer exist for our children. And so brilliance is something that can be nurtured, but it has to be recognized. So it's not that we're so smart. Maybe we had a little more courage, but it's not that we're so smart. It's that because of our families or neighborhoods or communities, somebody somewhere nurtured us. It wasn't necessarily the schools, probably wasn't. But we had somebody in our lives who cared deeply about us and who encouraged us anyway. And that's what I would like people to know, that no matter what's going on, for each and every child that's out there, we have got to give them on an individual level some support. There needs to be somebody who is crazy about each and every child because it makes the difference.
Yeah.